YouTube takes a minute to get started. So it's a great pleasure to have Nathanael Beresticky for the third lecture of this three-lecture mini course. I should remind the viewers that this lecture is being recorded and uploaded in cloud and also being live streamed on YouTube. Okay, so Nathanael, please take it away.
All right. So welcome back, everybody. Welcome back to the the season finale of this mini course. So quick recap, we had the first lecture about Gaussian multiplicative chaos, explained a bit the theory. Yes, the second lecture was devoted to a construction of an analogous theory, but for steep points of Brownian motion and connection with random walks, also steep points of random walk. And today we're going to sort of complete the loop, complete the circle. We're going to enhance this theory and talk about Brownian loop soup, and we will see how that brings us back to the Gaussian multiplicative chaos of the first lecture. So the first thing I'm going to do is to give you an introduction, a very short introduction to Brownian loop soup, because I think probably many of you are not very familiar with it. Maybe have seen it once or twice before, but not much more than that. So I'm going to call PT of ZZ. This is a strange notation because actually it doesn't depend on Z. This is 1 over 4 pi T. This is, I think of it as the transition probability from Z to Z in time T for Brownian motion with the same normalization that I had chosen on the first day. So the speed of Brownian motion is 2, and that's why we've got a 4 here and not a 2. And right, so let me pick this notation. So here, this is the law of a Brownian bridge from Z to Z in time T. And so with this notation, I'm going to consider a measure on loops, on rooted loops. So measure on rooted loops. So let me call it like that. So this is an integral over C dz, and then an integral from 0 to infinity dt over t pt zz, and then the law of a Brownian bridge in time t from z to z. Okay, so we are summing over all possible starting points of the loop. Z is going to be the starting point. These loops, they're rooted because when you have a Brownian bridge, there's a natural starting point for this Brownian bridge, which is its position at time zero. And so we're just integrating over all possible starting point. We're considering all possible time durations for this loop, it's T. And this is, if you like, you can think of this together as being not a probability measure, but a finite measure for any fixed T. It's a finite measure, which is the law of Brownian motion restricted to trajectories that go from Z to Z in time T. Okay, so so that's what the rooted loop measure is. And let me just point out, this is probably obvious, this is an infinite measure. For many reasons. So here, one obvious reason is that I'm sort of doing this in a whole plane. Even if I were to restrict myself to some bounded domain, for instance, I could ask the starting point to be in the domain, and I could ask the entire loop to stay in the domain. The corresponding integral here would be finite. And here you would get rid of one divergence at infinity because the probability for a long Brownian loop to remain in the domain D for a very, very long time decays exponentially in T. But you wouldn't get rid of the divergence that we have T here when T is close to zero. Okay, so here there's sort of no way to get rid of that divergence. It's really fundamentally there. This measure is infinite, at least because of very, very short loops. It's often better to view this measure as a measure on unrooted loops. What does that mean? It means it means that I'm going to forget the starting point of the loop. And another way to put it is, you know, I can declare two loops to be equivalent if I can, you know, sort of just translate one and get the same loop. So just choose a different starting point for the loop. So this is an equivalence relation, and so formally, so if I have this measure on rooted loops, I can turn it into a measure on unrooted loops. And then this is a nice choice because this dt over t, you can think of it, if you like, as rerouting the loop somewhere random, if you like. So this is like the choice of a route, if you like, that is uniform at random. So there is a question in the chat. Can this be interpreted as a sort of Itô excursion measure? Not quite. No, I don't think so, because so there will be excursions showing up in the Itô excursions showing up later on. But you know, an excursion from Z to Z would just not return to Z except at the start and at the end. Whereas here we have really loops. Yes, maybe this was not a very good. Of course, a loop will also not revisit the origin except at its starting point. But it's not the same measure, definitely. So, it's not an excursion measure. It really is just, you know, just a Brownian bridge measure in the sense that the x and the y coordinates, they are both independent Brownian bridges. Okay, so that's just what it is. So one advantage of doing that, for instance, is that you get once you consider this measure as being on unrooted loops, you get, for instance, a property of conformal invariance, which, you know, you don't have if you keep the root in mind when you apply a conformal map. Here, you know, the if you like, the starting point of the loop is sort of uniform on the domain, and if you apply a conformal map, the uniform measure on the domain is not transformed into a uniform measure. So if you want conformal invariance, it's clear that you need to forget about the starting point of the root and of the loop, and indeed you do get it. So this is one nice property that you get when you forget about the root. So this is the measure on this infinite measure on rooted or unrooted loops. You know, I'm interested in the Brownian loop soup. So what is a Brownian loop soup? It's very simple. The definition is the following, simply that the Brownian loop soup with intensity theta is a Poisson point process so a Poisson point process with intensity measure theta times mu loop. And in reality, often I only consider the loops that stay in a given domain D that's going to be finite, I mean bounded and open. So let me just say restricted to loops remaining in open, let's say bounded domain D. Okay, so I could either restrict directly the measure mu loops to loops staying in DL in the domain D, and then consider the Poisson point process with this intensity, well, theta times that intensity measure. Or I could take the full plane Poisson point process of loops and just consider those loops that stay consistently in the domain D. That's the same thing. So that's the Brownian loop soup, and theta is really, okay, it's an intensity. You can think of it as a sort of density of loops, okay? So. So I have a picture. It's actually difficult to draw pictures of this thing. Oh, that's not where I want the picture. I want it here. Good. So this this is a simulation done by Camia, Gandolfi, and Kleban. I took it from one of their papers. You see two simulations here with different value of the intensity parameter theta. So here theta is 0.5, and here theta is 2.5. Yes, so in reality, this is, I mean, I should sort of comment a bit on what you see in this picture. In reality, what happens is basically every point is covered by the loop soup because of very, very short range loops, sort of infinitesimally small loops. So in reality, what this picture shows you is a regularization of this loop soup in which you've removed loops that were too short one way or the other. So this is what's called an ultraviolet regularization. Still, the picture is very interesting and suggests that there are qualitative differences to the loop soup when you change the value of theta. In particular, you suspect that there are some interesting percolation effect that takes place when you increase theta. So that's actually true. You can talk of clusters of loops. So a clusters of loop, is really just a connected finite chain, of loops that intersect. And we can look at maximal such things. So that define clusters of loops. This is a well-defined notion. And you can ask for which value of theta, if you do this in the full plane, for which value of theta are you going to have infinite cluster, unbounded clusters, and for which value of theta are you not going to see this? And it so happens that this critical value can be computed explicitly, and it's theta equals a half. So clusters are finite, well, unbounded, let me say, sorry. And here they're unbounded. So this was proved by Sheffield and Werner, if I'm not mistaken. What year exactly, I don't know. So we actually know, they were able to prove much more than that. In fact, let me just say that at theta equals one half, the outer boundaries of the clusters can be described explicitly and are given by what's called CLE4. Okay, so this is sort of the percolation aspect of things. You look at these clusters and you look at the outer boundary. When you remove this cluster of loops, you look at the unique unbounded connected component of the complement. And so that's the boundary of that is what's called the outer boundary. And the outer boundaries can be described explicitly. They are given by CLE4. This is really a remarkable result. There's in fact an exact description of this outer boundary for every value of theta less than half. It's a certain CLE. It's a remarkable fact. And I want to say that actually the value theta equals half is special also for another reason. So special also for another reason. And this is Lejeune's isomorphism. I've alluded to it before. But Lejeune's isomorphism says that if you look at the local time or the occupation field of this loop soup, so this is my notation. So we take theta equals half. We are in some given domain D. That's what this means, this notation. And L of this means the local time, the total local time of these loops is given by one half of Gaussian free field in the domain D squared. Exactly. Okay, actually I should sort of qualify this. Normally, the way we qualify this is we put two dots on either side because really these quantities, they are pointwise finite. So what this means is that we first have to do some regularization and then subtract the expectation and then let the regularization scale go to zero to get a real identity between fields. Okay, so this these two dots here, this is what's called a weak regularization. Okay, so this is just you can ignore that if you're not so familiar with these things and just take it literally, but just remember that it is a, if you want to take it literally, then it's a formal identity. So there is this value theta equals half is special because of percolation, and it's special because of Lejeune's isomorphism, that just with this intensity, if you look at the local time, it is exactly given by one half the square of a Gaussian free field. This is a remarkable fact. In fact, there is an even more amazing, I think, property of the loop soup. And what is L? Thank you. So there's two L here. This one is the loop soup. That one is the occupation field. So the local time accumulated by the loop soup somewhere. If you don't like the two dots, the regularization, you can think in discrete. There is a discrete version of this result, which is true, and which is really true point-wise, point by point. The total local time accumulated by all of the loops at any given vertex will be given by one half the square of a discrete Gaussian free field. This is actually the version that's proved by Lejeune. Does that answer your question, Sergei? Yeah. If it's still not clear, please feel free to ask again. So I wanted to say that there is an even more remarkable property of a relation between these three objects that I've mentioned. And so this is, I don't know if they give a name to it. There is a canonical coupling, which is something proved by Wei Qian and Wendelin Werner. Right, sorry. So Sergei, so what is H in the right-hand side? So this is a Gaussian free field. Very important. Gaussian free field with Dirichlet boundary condition. Mm-hmm. Is that clear?
Thank you. So
I alluded to this before. Maybe let me just say one word about this. I've mentioned that there are various kinds of isomorphism. They all have a bit this flavor. that you have a Brownian-like trajectory. You look at its local time, and it's basically one half of the Gaussian free field squared. And depending on exactly what version you take of the Brownian trajectory, you have to tilt a bit the law of the Gaussian free field. So this is, I think, one of the cleanest versions that I know, certainly, in which you get exactly the Gaussian free field on the right-hand side, and on the left-hand side, what you have to put in is the occupation fields of the Brownian loop soup with parameter theta equals half. So I wanted to say something about this this canonical coupling, which was a result of Wei-Chan and van der Linde-Werner. So you have, on the one hand, there are three objects that I've mentioned. There is a Brownian loop soup. There is a Gaussian free field. And there is CLE4. And these three, they are coupled, these three objects exist on the same probability space in a way that is very canonical. So the Brownian loop soup and the Gaussian free field in this coupling, they are related in such a way that they satisfy Lejeune's isomorphism. The Brownian loop soup and the CLE4, they are related because the CLE4 is exactly describing the outer boundary of the clusters of the Brownian loop soup. And what is truly remarkable is that there is a relation between the Gaussian free field and the CLE4. And let me just say that in this relation, CLE4 is the level line of the Gaussian free field. And this is in the sense of Miller and Sheffield. Right, so this, when you take theta equals half, so this is something, a lot of very nice things are happening. So it is a really very special value of the intensity. So that was my brief introduction to Brownian loop soup. Here, what do we want to do? We want to answer questions that relate to the connection between, let's say, the thick points of the Gaussian free field, like Liouville measure, and the structure of the Brownian loop soup near this thick point. So the question we have in mind is what is the structure of the Brownian loop soup at a Liouville typical point? Okay, so take a typical point, a typical thick point of the Gaussian free field. And you can ask yourself, near this point, what type of loops do you see? What is the geometry of loops? Are you going to see what sort of things are you going to see there? And so I've already sort of slightly explained how I'm going to think about a question like this in the title of the lecture, because really what I'm going to do is I'm going to construct a multiplicative chaos associated to the Brownian loop soup. So we will see that doing this is exactly what allows us to answer questions about what is the structure of the Brownian loop soup near Liouville typical points. So this is everything I'm going to say here is going to be it's a joint work with Elie Aidécon, Antoine Jégot, and Titus Lupu. So the work is not yet on archive, but it will be probably within well, a short amount of time. There's a question on chat. Liouville typical? Yes. So Liouville, I remind you that what is Liouville measure, it's just a Gaussian multiplicative chaos associated with the Gaussian free field. So we know what that means. You sample a point according to Liouville measure, a typical thick point for the Gaussian free field. What does a loop soup look like near that? How does a loop soup look like in order to build a thick point for the Gaussian free field? Okay, that's the question we have in mind. Thank Remember you. That we expect, since the field, you know, the field and the loop soup is related by Legendre's isomorphism. So if you want a thick point for the Gaussian free field, you need a lot of occupation measure at this point. This occupation measure, it's not clear how it is constructed. Maybe there's one loop that is extremely thick there. Maybe there's a ton of loops that go through the point, but apart from that, they're all fairly typical. You know, this is not so clear at all a priori. Is that clear? The question I'm trying to address. So it's not a surprise. What I'm going to do is. You know, I have already a notion of multiplicative chaos associated to a finite number of trajectories. And this is what's already been constructed in these two papers. So recall that. So we have this paper by Heidi Kuhn, who and she, as well as the paper by Jego, both in 2020, which give a meaning to multiplicative chaos for a finite number of Brownian trajectories. So you know, this is a good starting point. And so what we're going to do is we're going to want to regularize the loop soup. Use these measures somehow. You know, once you have not too many trajectories, you can hope to use this measure constructed in these two papers, and then you know, let the regularization scale go to zero somehow, and hope to prove a convergence result. Okay, so that's the idea. How you do the regularization? Initially, it's not so clear how you might want to do that. Perhaps you could require the diameter to be greater than epsilon. So this, you remove every loop that's smaller than epsilon in diameter. So that's certainly one way of approximating your loop soup with a finite number of loops. You could require the duration to be greater than epsilon squared. That's roughly the same thing by Brownian scaling. So it turns out none of these would work easily, at least with our techniques. So we have a different way of regularizing the loop soup. And well, it is sort of important to use that way and not another way. I will try to explain why. So instead, we're going to fix k to be a positive number. And what we're going to do is I'm going to pick every loop in my loop soup with probability 1 minus exponential minus k times the duration of this loop. Okay, so if you like, every loop is scaled at constant rate k. And I consider the collection of loops that are scaled. Okay, so L D theta of K, so this is the collection of killed loops. Killed or selected. I will try to explain later why this is a nice choice. Let me say that you know, when k increase, the rate at which you're selecting the loop becomes high, and so you know, you're very likely to select any given loop, and so so when k increase to infinity, you know, the union of this collection is the entire collection. Okay, so I think, if you like, of this LD theta of k, the collection of killed loops as an approximation, a thinner collection of loops, but you know, a pretty good approximation of my entire loop soup. It's still not a finite number of loops, but we can see that in fact it's a collection that's not too thick. So the density of these loops is basically finite. So at every scale epsilon, there's only going to be a finite number of loops. And so maybe let me write this as a proposition. It is not too hard to see that if we fix some thickness A in 0,2, theta and intensity arbitrary, then we have, you know, I can look at the multiplicative chaos associated to this collection of loops. It's not a finite collection of loops, so it requires a bit more than what's done in these papers, but not much more, because it's an infinite collection of loops, but not badly infinite. So so the multiplicative chaos let me call it MKA associated to this collection of loop so is almost surely a finite measure. Okay, so I have a well-defined chaos with this sub-collection of loops. It's basically finite. I mean, it's not finite, but you can pretend it is if you like. So with this, let me tell you what is the first statement. The first statement, so again, this is with Elie Aidécon, myself, Antoine, Chego, and Titus Lupu. And the statement says that if I consider the multiplicative chaos associated to this killed loops, then with an appropriate normalization, then this has a limit as k tends to infinity, a measure that I'll call M, or MA maybe. And this is the this is what I want to call the chaos associated to the loop soup with intensity theta. Later on, I will maybe in a few minutes I will describe another approximation which maybe is a bit more transparent because it comes from the discrete. And so it's a bit easier to state things in the discrete and to have to state what is the approximation. So I will do that in a few minutes. Maybe this would be more transparent. Right. So this is the object that defines the multiplicative chaos associated to a Brownian loop soup. It's defined by this theorem, if you like. Let me just say that formally, this measure corresponds to so MA of DZ, it's basically okay, so let me put a quotation mark here. It's essentially the exponential of gamma times the square root of the local time of this loop soup. Okay, so like in the for the case of a finite number of Brownian trajectories, the multiplicative chaos was the exponential not of the local time but of the square root of the local time. There's actually a factor two here, which is just a question of normalization, where here A and gamma, they are related in the same way as what I explained before. A is the thickness parameter for the local time, and gamma is the thickness, you know, from the point of view of the Gaussian free field, if you like. And so they are related by this relation, which is, you know, one way of, this relation is comes from Lejeune's isomorphism, let's say. Okay, so this is local time is half of the Gaussian free field square. Right. So this is, you know, formally one way to think of this measure. It defines the exponential of gamma times the square root of the local time field of the loop soup. And maybe an obvious thing you might want to ask is to ask what is the relation to the Gaussian free field. Okay, so if I want to see a relation to the Gaussian free field, it seems clear that I need to select the intensity to be the special value theta equals half. So far, we did not choose it. It was a general theta. So pick theta equals half. And then by Lejeune's isomorphism, so let's do a formal calculation. Well, the local time of this loop soup, we know it's one half of the Gaussian free field square. So so this measure that we've just constructed, it should correspond to exponential of gamma. So square root of twice the local time, well, twice the local time would be h squared, and the square root of h squared is just the absolute value of h. Now, because h is not really defined pointwise, it turns out this exponential of absolute value of h is actually the same thing as exponential of gamma times h plus exponential minus gamma times h. Okay, and this is because, you know, this is because you, because h is actually typically either very big or very small. Right, this is, such an identity is definitely wrong for continuous function. It will get you thrown out of calculus one, I believe. But because it's a Gaussian free field, you can actually expect it to be true. And in fact, we show it is true. So let me just say, you know, this is the same thing, of course, as the twice the, at least formally, the hyperbolic cosine of the Gaussian free field. And so so this was a formal calculation, but it can be made rigorous. And so this is the content of the next theorem, also with the same authors. So fix theta equals half, and A is gamma squared over two. Then the measure we've just constructed is given by, okay, there were some constants that I didn't tell you about, but times h. Okay, so in other words, it's mu, yes, in distribution. Thank you very much. So this is mu gamma plus mu minus gamma. So this is of dz. Okay, so this is the Liouville measure with parameter plus or minus gamma. So this is well defined in the same range of values. So the Liouville measure is defined normally, you know, we say gamma is in 0,2, but of course I also have for free gamma in minus 0,2 because minus H is also a Gaussian free field. Okay, so there is this symmetry. So I don't have to work to construct mu minus gamma. It exists also in exactly in the range of values where gamma is between 0 and 2. So these measures, we've already encountered them. They're the measures that we discussed on the very first lecture. It's Gaussian multiplicative chaos associated with the sum of these two parameters. So if you like, it's an unsigned version of Gaussian multiplicative chaos, this hyperbolic cosine. I see that there's a question in the chat. Is this in law? So, right, okay, good question. Actually, I don't remember what it is exactly we proved, but I think, so we certainly have it in law, that's clear. But I think we have more than that. And I think now we can say it is, it's a very good question, Hélène. It's really the measure associated with the realization of the Gaussian free field that you get by summing these two Liouville measures. Okay, it's not obvious, in fact. I hope I'm not mistaken by claiming that. So, in fact, initially we did not have that, and it's recently that we were able to add it to the result. So, I hope these two theorems are clear. If there are questions on the statement, please feel free to ask. Also later, that's also fine. I want to mention some consequences that I've sort of promised as part of the motivation, if you like. So the first consequence that I want to mention is one that I like very much, but it's kind of informal. Right, so Antoine has a comment on, yes, but so, okay. let me not spend time discussing Antoine's comment. So I want to mention the consequence, which I like very much, but it is an informal consequence. And this consequence is the following. This theorem, let's say theorem one, well, the theorem one and theorem two together, they tell us something about how we can think about this Brownian multiplicative chaos that I defined in the second lecture. Basically, what it says is that this Brownian multiplicative chaos, you can think of it as the infinitesimal contribution of each loop to Liouville measure, or rather to the hyperbolic cosine, because we're talking about the unsigned version of Liouville measure. Okay, so you can ask yourself, you have your Gaussian free field, and we have Liouville measure, or its hyperbolic cosine. This Gaussian free field is associated with a sea of loops, the Brownian loop soup that is canonically coupled with the Gaussian free field. And you can ask yourself, how much did each loop contribute to the Liouville measure, or to the hyperbolic cosine? And the answer that is given exactly by this theorem is that the infinitesimal contribution of each loop is given by the Brownian multiplicative chaos that was defined in these two papers of Antoine and Eli Zan and Yuyun. I see that there's a question in the chat by Francis Comets. You now take negative gammas. Does it mean you can discuss thin points for planar Brownian motion as well as you did for thin points? I wish, but no. Sadly, no. This is simply because we are still talking about thick points, both for the Gaussian free field It's just we are talking either of thick points for h or thick points for minus h. That is really what we're talking about. Either way, they remain thick points. So the point is that, you know, when you square the Gaussian free field, you don't know whether it was a thick point for h or for minus h. You get a thick points for the square and you don't know what it is. So the thick points for the local time, they could be a thick point for h or a thick point for minus h. But either way, it's still a thick point. Is that, yeah, good. So let me just say that. So Brownian chaos is the infinitesimal. This is, you know, not something that is you can say rigorously what it means, but this is clearly the meaning of this theorem. It's the infinitesimal contribution of each loop to the hyperbolic cosine cosh of the Gaussian free field, or even measure if you like, up to the sine. And the second consequence that I want to say is the one that I basically motivated this question with. And the question is pick a Liouville typical point. Okay, so from mu gamma or from cosh gamma, it's going to be the same thing. So, you know, what is the structure of the Brownian loop soup? Ah, there's a comment by Gurab. Lubu has a coupling which determines the sine from the square in cable graphs. Do you think that might be useful for the thin points? So I don't think so. I certainly think it's useful to get the sine. So if you're interested in the sine, and maybe this is something we will discuss at some point. But if you're interested in getting the sign right, then basically this coupling that Titus did is will help you do it. To get thin points, you really have to think, you really have to speak of something else. The thin points, they are not going to be given by the exponential of the free field. The sort of the exponential of the free field by sort of nature just talks about points where it's big, either big positive or big negative, but not points where it's close to zero. And thin points, at least in the sense of random walks, they're more related to, in reality, to places where the free field is close to zero. This is my, this is how I think of it, at least. But so again, so I wanted to pick a typical Liouville point and ask how many loops go through it. Right, so, well, we know it's a thick point for the free field, so we expect that there's going to be a lot of occupation measure, as I said there, that's Lejeune's isomorphism. But so probably there's going to be at least one loop. But is it one loop that's very, very thick at this point, or is it an entire collection of loops? Maybe each loop is sort of somewhat typical, but the accumulation of loops makes this very thick. Maybe that's, or, you know, maybe it's something in between. I don't know. It could be many different things. So what is the thickness of each loop? At Z. So this is theorem three that I want to state. So I think it gives a nice answer. So essentially, let me call this Gersonov theorem. This is really the analog of the Gersonov theorem I very briefly mentioned in the Gaussian context, where if you have a Gaussian field and you sample from the exponential of this Gaussian field, then you can describe it as, you can describe the resulting law as a the original Gaussian field plus some deterministic drift. So this is what we do here. So we can sample from this measure. So So first of all, the point Z itself has a law which is proportional to what's called the conformal radius raised to the power A. So this is the conformal radius. I don't think we've seen it before, but in reality, it appeared, and I just didn't say it before in the context of Liouville measure. So I will maybe define it in a second. Times dz, this is not of dz, this is times dz. Furthermore, conditionally on z, the law of L can be described as follows. So first of all, it is a Brownian loop soup in D with intensity theta. Let me write it with my notation. To which we are going to add a bunch of loops which all visit Z, and these collection are independent and they are distributed as follows. So first we're going to pick A1, A2, dot, dot, dot. So this is called, this is going to be a Poisson-Dirichlet theta partition of 0A. I'm going to define that in a second. But it's an infinite collection of numbers that sum to A. A is the total thickness that we're shooting for. And what we're going to do with this AI is just concatenate. So each loop in loop Z is obtained by concatenating excursions, by concatenating the excursions in a Poisson point process of excursions AI times mu ZD. So here, this is the excursion measure. This is the Ito excursion measure. So there was a question at the beginning of the lecture today. Okay, so we have a notion of excursion from Z to Z in the domain D. We take an intensity AI of those. Each of those, each of these excursions in this Poisson point process, you know, start at Z and return at Z, and we can concatenate them together. That's going to give us a loop which visits Z. For each AI, we have therefore a law for a certain loop, and you know, this loop returns many, many times to Z, sort of AI many times, if you like. And but you know, AI is a sort of a continuum number of visits, and so together, you know, we do that for each value AI in this Poisson Dirichlet partition, and that describes entirely the law of the loop soup. Okay, so in particular, Z has loop multiplicity, which is infinite. Okay, because this Poisson Dirichlet partition is infinite, almost surely. And as we can see, it's not very difficult to see once we have this description, each loop has thickness AI at Z. Okay, so this is why the overall thickness is A, because the sum of the AI is equal to A. So we have an infinite number of loops going through Z, and how is the sickness spread out among those groups? It's spread out exactly according to an independent Poisson-Dirichlet partition with parameter theta. Okay, so what is this Poisson-Dirichlet partition? So maybe remark. What is that? So here's my interval 0, A actually, you know, we're going to scale it so that A is equal to 1. And this is, you can describe that very easily by what's called the stick breaking construction. So what you do is you start by chopping off one bit, and this bit is has a beta distribution with parameter 1 and theta. So this is a uniform random variable to the power 1 over theta. And then you iterate this construction. You have the rest of the interval, maybe here. And so you're going to chop off a proportion, which is another beta random variable. And that's going to give you another bit of the Poisson-Dirichlet partition. And you keep going until eventually you're creating smaller and smaller bits. Okay, and it goes you exhaust the entire interval with an infinite collection of AI here. Is that clear how they're defined? So this is, you know, the sort of informal description of what is a Poisson-Dirichlet distribution, and you can quickly recover what it is formally by taking products of 1 minus these beta random variables. Are there questions on what it means? So yeah, I should say when theta equals one, the beta distribution is just a uniform distribution. The Poisson-Dirichlet with parameter theta equals one is maybe the most canonical. It corresponds, for instance, to the cycle structure of random uniform permutation in the scaling limit. And so here, you know, the canonical parameter for us is rather theta equals half. And theta equals half is, it's maybe not quite as canonical a Poisson-Dirichlet distribution. I find this interesting. I'm not quite sure what to make of it. I should say that, of course, you know, theta equals half, one is twice theta equals half. Okay, this is not a big surprise. But, you know, when you have a loop soup with intensity one, you can recover it as a sum of two independent loop soup with parameter half. And so there is actually, it's possible to write the measure associated with theta equals one in terms of sort of products and of Liouville measures, of independent Liouville measures. So there is a way of, so it won't be a product actually. So there's gonna be, it's possible to rewrite it in some other way, this the loop soup, the measure for theta equals one in terms of Liouville measures, but it's not a particularly transparent interpretation, at least not that I know of. Are there questions on the meaning of this theorem or the statement? Am I actually out of time? No.
Right on time, maybe.
Oh close. My God. I'm close to okay, so I wanted to say quite a bit more. I didn't realize, so that's okay. I should say something about these theorems. At the heart of it, there is a certain martingale which you can come up with, and roughly speaking, this martingale, at least a posteriori, this martingale describes the conditional expectation of our Brownian loop soup chaos given the loops killed with parameter k. So of course, when you increase K, that should give you a martingale. You're just increasing the filtration. But in reality, you know, the definition of this martingale itself is you know, this is something that you can only realize a posteriori, that it's equal to that. And in fact, the definition of this martingale is really far from clear. There's a formula for it, but it's actually quite ugly. And still, it is something that can be analyzed. And maybe I can spend 1 minute to explain why there's something that can be analyzed, because it comes down to the reason why the choice of regularization we took is a nice choice of regularization. And this is because of the following fact. If I have my Brownian loop soup, I can, you know, consider separately the loops that are killed and the loops that are not killed. The loops that are not killed, in reality, so the complement of those that are of interest to us, if you like, these in fact form what's called a massive loop soup, meaning that if I look at their occupation time, it's going to be 1/2 of the square of a massive Gaussian free field, meaning that in the Green function, meaning that really each loop is killed with some constant rate. That's exactly what it means. But the point is that we can describe exactly their occupation field thanks to another isomorphism. And so when you take the conditional expectation given the killed loops, there is a way of sort of guessing the sort of form this martingale might take, because it sort of involves this massive Gaussian free field, if you like. Anyway, so the point is that I'm trying to make is that this regularization is nice because it's there's some special properties you can guess, which would be very hard to obtain with different regularizations. And there's a second property, maybe I can take 30 seconds and write this down because I find that very surprising. And there's a second property which is true, which is really, which is at the heart of why we can say anything about this problem. And which is that even when K is finite, we can compute exactly the not only the first moment of the measure, but more precise quantity. And so there is an exact expression in terms of a function here, which is so related to a hypergeometric function. So there is something that can be computed totally explicitly and is really the engine that drives the proof. This is, there seems to be some exact solvability here, which we don't totally understand. I think part of the explanation is what I said, but there, you know, it seems to go beyond that. We don't really understand why it's there. It seems to not have been noticed before, as far as we know, at least, that regularizing your loop soup with killed loops gives rise to exact formula in this way. There seems to be some remarkable structure. We're very lucky that sort of this regularization simplifies the problem in two different ways. Maybe they're related, maybe not. We don't really understand why it's there, but it is there, and it's fundamental for the entire paper. Okay, so I'm sorry for going a few minutes over time, and I hope you found this course interesting, and I've made you want to take a look at some of these papers. So thank you very much.
Thank you.